McLuhan's technological optimism echoes Heisenberg's ideological idealism. The Canadian prophet claimed that media intensification would put people in touch with each other and bring about a new age of freedom, a global village, transcending geographical boundaries. Actually, it didn't bring clarity in communication or create communality on a global scale, but just a reverse. Meaning disappeared through the saturation of images and the speed of communication. The fascination exerted by the medium induced, in fact, mass passivity. Pure contact replaced contents. It was what Baudrillard called the ecstasy of communication, the implosion of meaning through the medium. Producing non-communication by means of communication, participation turned to inertia, mindless absorption and irresponsibility. Even the poles, thrown like a net over a muted populations, excluded any real response. Formatted result merely confirmed simulated questions. Requiem for the Media was published in a book called For a Critique of the Political Economy of the Sign, and it is part of the critical period of Baudrillard, which is the first period, the first introduction of Baudrillard in the United States also, because it was published in 1969-1970 by a Marxist outfit called Tilos, and the first time that he was accepted in this country as a philosopher was as a Marxist, because if you criticize Marxists, you're still a Marxist, right? And Baudrillard was a Marxist in that respect. And what we're talking about now is the time where after 68, after all the hope for change and revolution were dissipated, it took a little while for him to realize that to critique the system was not enough. Now we had to take a less passive or less critical and a more aggressive way of dealing with it. And that's why he's trying to elaborate by writing through a symbolic exchange and death, and through a direct attack, which is a polemic, and through a performative type of writing. So Requiem for the Media was published in For a Critique of the Political Economy of the Sign, which is a takeoff on Marx's title and activity. For him, political economy means that we live in a society where everything is part of the political economy. Signs themselves are part of the political economy, of the economy, because there is no more distinction between one area and another, right? Consumerism is that, is the abolition not only of classes, but every single distinction on which Marxism relied in order to not just to elaborate this theory, but also to prepare the workers for a fight which never happened. Or when the fight was ready to happen, then they weren't there exactly because they became dependent on the machine and didn't want the machine to be tarnished by the fight, as happened in France. It was still a critique, however radical it claimed to be. Its conclusion weren't that different from the situationist indictment of the media manipulation. Like them, Baudrillard at the time was calling for direct action, urging his readers somewhat rhetorically to break the monopoly of speech. Quote, the only revolution in that area, he wrote, and everywhere else, revolution pure and simple, lies in the restitution of this possibility of response and the complete transformation of the present structure of the media. May 68, obviously, was still in his mind in 72. Why otherwise would he have picked street speech as an exemplary revolutionary medium, also posters, graffiti, etc., all the major tool of May 68. Only the symbolic exchange of speech, he said at the time, instantaneous, unmediated, perishable, would possibly escape media exchange and any attempt at specularization. Quote, theory is no other theory or strategy possible, he declared. There is no other theory or strategy possible, he declared at the time. I remind you that it seems strange at this time to say that, but Baudrillard and Guattari were together at the time in a Maoist group. Right? Okay. Little did Baudrillard know, his invocation of the logic of the gift, Marcel Mauss of symbolic exchange, was at the time like a mantra. He hadn't yet found a way of using his own analysis performatively. Actually, it was a pamphlet that allowed him to make this kind of quantum leap and leave behind an invocation of another type of economy, which functioned in some sort of a oppositional way to the principle of equivalence of capital, and really explore the possibility of a symbolic exchange in relation to death, because that's the title of the book. We'll talk about that later if we may. They made him realize that he could use reversal in a polemical strategy. Let me clarify, I've told already that to my students. By the time Baudrillard wrote this, he had already published Simulation, which may be famous in the United States. And Simulation is based on the reversal. Reversal means, for instance, that Walt Disney is not something artificial. It is, in fact, the whole of America, which is artificial and creates an artificial little enclosure to prove that it is natural, right? So this kind of reverse is at work in the whole of Simulation. Simulation is simply the fact that we live in a world where the same way the object were not what circulated in a consumer society, but the signs of the object and the difference between the objects were creating desires among consumers. The same way, what circulates is not images that simulated something, but images that simulated other images, which simulated other images, which simulated other images without any original. And that's why this was, of course, totally misread in New York at the time. It became some sort of bestseller because people thought he was talking about reappropriation, simulation of something, etc., where Baudrillard was, at the time, becoming as metaphysical as the system itself was becoming, and saying that there is no representation, reality itself is being excluded, or rather the principle of reality, but now we're entering a new era, which was an era of total abstraction, which was part of the new stage, the post-40s stage, where it was not goods that circulated, but signs, right? That everyone would be at their computer, and that sign would have a weight of matter, if you want. The immateriality replaced materiality of the productive area. So, they made him realize that he could use reversal as a polemic strategy, escalating a system to the extreme limit until it doubled down according to its own logic. Foucault happened to be his first casualty, and it was all the more ironical that his adversary himself had advocated using exactly the same method. I quote Foucault. As in judo, he wrote, "The best answer to an adversary's maneuver is not to retreat, but to go along with it, turning it to one's advantage as a resting point for the next phase." Right? And this is exactly the kind of logic that Baudrillard had turned against Foucault, admiring Foucault, admiring so much that he goes beyond Foucault and leaves Foucault on the preceding spiral of power and sexuality. He leaves Foucault where he thinks Foucault is at that point, in what he would call a state of a ghost, what he calls the phantom limb of the capital. Right? Baudrillard used Foucault against Foucault in more ways than one. With Forget Foucault, it became clear to him that the goal of a destabilizing strategy was not to defeat one's adversary, but to allow for something else to appear that wouldn't have been perceptible otherwise. What his challenge revealed is that Foucault's own reversal of the status of power, his attempt to define power not coming from the top, but diffused throughout society, which was the main Foucauldian revolution, his effort to turn power upside down and make it leak from all sides through networks and rhizomes, if you want. Still, that was an analysis of power.